McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Understanding Stocks, 3rd Edition, by Michael Sincere, narrated by Walter Dixon. Publisher's Note: This audiobook contains bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. Preface: What You Need to Know First. I want to thank you for taking the time to buy my book, the 3rd edition of Understanding Stocks. Because of the success of the previous editions, my editors at McGraw-Hill asked me to write another edition. Because the stock market has gone through so many changes, and I've learned so much more since I wrote earlier versions, I eagerly accepted the assignment. You'll notice numerous improvements in this edition. I rewrote the book from scratch, sentence by sentence, making sure you received the most up-to-date information, strategies, and tactics. I did my best to make sure this was the best possible book on the stock market. A new and improved book. You're in the right place if you want to learn how to buy and sell stocks and other financial products. The stock market is one of the greatest places on earth to make money, either slowly or quickly. Even though learning about stocks is a serious subject, I also made sure this book was an entertaining and educational listen. As with all my other books, I explain stocks as if you were sitting across from me at the kitchen table. My goal is to save you time and money while offering different ways to build wealth. In addition, if you are listening to this book out of curiosity, your needs should be met. Before writing this version of Understanding Stocks, I spent several years experimenting, testing, and evaluating the market. I approached the stock market as a scientist, conducting numerous experiments to determine what worked and what didn't. Based on my research, I was able to rewrite this book with an enhanced perspective. I am very eager to share what I learned with you. As an added bonus, I include a number of interviews with some of the most successful investors in history. Why you should listen to this book. If you're thinking of entering the stock market or are already participating and losing money, this could be the most useful book you ever listened to. I took the classes, read the books, watched the videos, and talked to dozens of pros. I also invested and traded stocks, and along the way, I made every conceivable mistake, which I will help you to avoid. This book was also designed to help you quickly learn how to invest or trade stocks. Thousands of books have already been written about the stock market, some quite technical and tedious. I was amazed to discover that so many boring books had been written about such a fascinating subject. Just like you, I hate reading books that put me to sleep by the second chapter. This is why I was determined to write an easy-to-read book about the market. Even though this book is relatively short, it is packed with information about investing and trading. I wanted to write something that I could hand to you and say, "Listen to this book if you want to learn about the stock market." You don't have to be a dummy, idiot, or fool to understand the market. You also don't have to be a genius. After you listen to this book, you will realize that understanding stocks is not that hard. The hard part is making money, but we will get to that later. Another reason I urge you to listen to this book: I want you to learn about the market so you don't have to get stock ideas from columnists, friends, or tip givers who appear on financial programs. Some of these people may have good information, but many don't. The bottom line: you are listening to this book because you want to make money, and one of the best ways to make money is through the stock market. By the time you finish this book, you should have a good idea of what you need to do to get started, as well as knowing the participants, the rules, and the vocabulary. By educating yourself about the market, you can decide whether or how you want to join. Another reason you are listening to this book is to learn how to manage your own portfolio. Even if other people are managing your money, you'll have a better understanding of what they are doing or should be doing. If anything, this book should give you the confidence to succeed on your own. What's so great about stocks? If you are a beginner, you might wonder, what is so great about the stock market? Many people use the market as a vehicle to build wealth, fund their retirement, or have enough for emergencies. There are many ways to participate, and in this book, you will learn many of those methods. Perhaps that is why you bought this book. One of the best reasons to get involved with stocks is that you can go to work or stay at home knowing that your money is working for you behind the scenes. That's an exciting part about investing in the market. You have choices. You can live paycheck to paycheck, you can put your extra money in a savings account, or you can consider putting your money to work. Although the stock market isn't perfect, it has proved itself to be one of the best ways to increase wealth over the long or short term. At the very least, it's smart to learn everything you can about stocks. Do you think a particular stock is going to explode higher? There is a strategy that will help you profit. If you are concerned that the market will go down and you want to protect your investments, there is a strategy for doing that too. What if you want to make money but don't have time to watch the market? Yes, there is a strategy for doing that as well. The risks. As your author and educator, a job I take seriously, I want to tell you both the benefits and risks of trading and investing. There are risks when you are in the stock market, just as there are risks with most things in the financial arena. I am also realistic. Unfortunately, the market is not a fairy godmother that can solve all your financial worries. Most of the time, stocks are an excellent investment. But I also know that if you choose the wrong stock, or if the market plunges, or even crashes, a rare but occasional occurrence, you will lose money. That is why one of my main goals is to help you protect your money from taking large hits. Although you can never eliminate all risk, there are ways to limit losses to ensure that if you lose money in the market, losses may be painful, but never devastating. You also don't want to be a sitting duck, which is what happens when you don't take evasive action when the market falls. It's not enough to know when to get into the market. It's equally important to know when to get out. I will point out the clues that allow you to exit before the market drops significantly. The stock market can be brutal. I don't want to scare you, just prepare you. After my blunt warning, you may decide that you don't want to have anything to do with the stock market. That would be a serious mistake. First of all, understanding the market can help you with future financial decisions. The stock market is at the core of almost every country's financial system, and understanding how it works will help guide you for the rest of your life. Because the stock market can be a brutal game that favors the house, you should know what you're up against before you invest your first dime. Unfortunately, you can't win unless you know how to play. By the time you reach the last chapter, you should have a better idea of whether investing directly in the stock market makes sense for you. Although I can't make promises, it is also possible that understanding the stock market will help make your financial dreams come true. Perhaps you will invest in stocks, but I'll give you other investment ideas. Now is the time to start. It has never been a better time to be a trader or investor. Because of new technology, you have tools and equipment available that previous generations could only dream about. I will help you identify good buying opportunities and help you determine when a stock, or the market, should be avoided. Fortunately, you don't need a fortune to make a fortune. On occasion, you might hit a home run and make a lot of money fast. I also want you to learn how to make money not just for a day, but for a lifetime. Thank you. Thanks again for taking the time to listen to my book. I appreciate that of all the books you could have chosen, you chose mine. I will do my best to make you happy with that decision. My goal is to show you how to make a decent amount of money, a sum that varies for each person, on your own, so you don't have to rely on me or anyone else. I also hope that I inspire you to learn more about the stock market, the same way that I did. How to contact me. Finally, if you have any questions about my book or notice any errors, feel free to email me at msincere@gmail.com or visit my website, michaelsincere.com. I always enjoy hearing from you, and I'll try to answer promptly. Now, let's get to work. There's a lot to learn. Part 1. What you need to know first. Welcome to the stock market. In this book, I will act as your personal tour guide, showing you many different paths to achieving your financial goals. You may be surprised to learn that the market is not that difficult to understand. The hard part, as I wrote in the preface, is making money. Often, it is emotions, primarily fear, greed, and unrealistic expectations that prevent investors and traders from earning and keeping profits. One way to reduce emotion is to know the facts, and that is another reason why you are listening to this book. Speaking of facts, by the time you finish part one, you should have enough knowledge to sail through the rest of the book. The key is to learn about the market in small steps, which is how I present the information. Get ready for a fascinating and entertaining journey. Chapter 1. Welcome to the Stock Market. In this chapter, you will be introduced to the market participants, the overall environment, the vocabulary, and the difference between investing and trading. Most importantly, I show you where you fit in and the different ways you can enter the market. There are two main ways of participating in the market. First, you can be an investor, buying and holding stocks for long periods, or you can be a trader, buying and holding stocks for a short time. You can choose one method or both. You don't need to decide how to participate right now. Keep in mind there will be many distractions, from touts on financial programs who offer a dozen stock tips a day to hundreds of articles written about the stock market that urge you to buy this stock right now. At times, the stock market resembles a three-ring circus. I want to help you cut through the confusion and help you identify the information that is most important for your needs. What is the stock market? You will hear a lot of definitions about the stock market and what it can do for you. Many people like to say that it is the greatest wealth-building machine ever created. For some people, it is. The stock market is similar to a huge auction. With some low-priced stocks, it's more like a swap shop, where companies list shares so they can raise capital. In fact, when a company goes public, its shares are listed for trading and become available for anyone to trade on an exchange. The New York Stock Exchange, NYSE, is the best-known one. The place where members meet to buy and sell stocks is called a stock exchange. The exchange provides an organized marketplace for stocks, just as a supermarket provides a marketplace for food. As you probably know, buyers and sellers no longer meet in a physical location on the trading floor of a stock exchange, as they did in the old days. Now, shares are bought and sold primarily online, using computers. All you need is a computer, smartphone, or tablet, and you can participate in the stock market. It is not surprising that so many people are fascinated by the market. With a few clicks of a button or mouse, you can buy and sell shares of stock and other financial products from the comfort of your home. If all goes well, you can make money. What is a brokerage firm? When we talk about the stock market, we are really talking about the buying and selling of individual stocks and all the other financial products you will learn about. To participate in the market, you must sign up with a brokerage firm. A brokerage firm is a company that is licensed to buy and sell stocks on behalf of its clients. Most trading, buying and selling, is done by using an online brokerage firm, where you can trade over the internet. In the next chapter, I show you how to open an account and begin trading. What is a share of stock? This next part can get a little technical, but it will help explain the reason that the stock markets exist. The word stock originally came from the word livestock. Instead of trading cows and sheep, people trade pieces of paper, stock certificates that represent ownership, shares in a corporation. Stocks are also referred to as equities or securities. When you buy shares in a corporation, you are considered an investor or shareholder. As a shareholder, you are allowed one vote for each share of stock that you own. The more shares you own, the more of the corporation you control, and the more money you could earn if the stock price increases. Most shareholders, investors, own a tiny sliver of the corporation with little say over how the corporation is run. That means you aren't allowed to boss anyone around in the corporation. You'd have to own millions of shares of stock to become a primary owner of a corporation whose stock is publicly traded. On one side, you have the owners of corporations, who are looking for a convenient way to raise money so they can hire more employees, build more factories or offices, and upgrade their equipment. The way they raise money is by issuing shares of stocks to the public in an initial public offering, IPO, or secondary offering. On the other side are people like you and me who buy and sell shares of stock in those corporations. Remember, when you own a share of stock, you share in the success or failure of the business because you own part of the corporation. Note: there are two kinds of stock, common and preferred. In this book, we always refer to common stock because this type of stock attracts the most attention from buyers and sellers. The main difference between common and preferred is common stock gives voting rights to its shareholder and preferred does not. Only corporations issue stock. To issue stock, the business has to be a corporation, as legally defined. Most large companies that you know about are corporations. As examples, Alphabet, Apple, Boeing, Disney, General Electric, Home Depot, IBM, McDonald's, Microsoft, and Netflix, to name just a few, and their stocks are traded on one of the stock exchanges. Some companies are privately held and do not sell shares to the public. In summary, a corporation issues stock to generate money. Investors buy stock to participate in the success of the business. If the corporation does well, the stock price will probably increase and those investors will make money. If the corporation does poorly, the stock price will probably decline and investors lose money. Once a corporation goes public and its stock is traded on an exchange, the goal is to convince investors that the corporation is a worthwhile investment. Corporations do everything in their power to sell products and also attract money from investors. They also want to motivate major institutional investors to buy their stock. Larger corporations spread the word online and through print, television, and social media advertising. Smaller corporations rely more heavily on online advertising, especially social media, as well as on word of mouth, emails, and news releases. Professionals connected to Wall Street always say good things about the market. After all, they want the market to go up. On the other hand, if a stock gets slammed in the media for any reason, this creates negative headlines, which companies prefer to avoid. Initial public offering. The main motivation for a company to sell shares is to raise cash that is used to operate the business. They do that by selling shares and getting those shares listed on a stock exchange. After an initial public offering, the company is uninvolved in trading the shares. All trading and the profits and losses generated from buying and selling shares goes to investors, not the company. In other words, even if the stock price of Microsoft increased by 20%, the company gains only from the shares it already owns. It does not participate in shares sold to the public. Nevertheless, rising stock prices are great publicity and keep investors happy. You buy stocks for one reason: to make money. Investing in the stock market is all about making money, either quickly, short-term trading, or slowly, long-term investing. If you own shares of a corporation that does well and consistently grows profits, then you should expect to earn money as the stock price increases. Simply put, you earn money in the stock market when you sell shares at a price that is higher than the purchase price. There is no guarantee, of course, that you will make money. Even the shares of good corporations can decline sometimes, leading to a loss. Profits earned from a stock are called capital gains, which is the difference between your buy and sell prices. If you lose money, it is called a capital loss. This is the risk you take when participating in the stock market. Investors make money slowly. Investors buy stocks in corporations whose shares they believe to be undervalued. They plan to hold the shares for the long term, often for years. Investors generally ignore short-term, day-to-day price fluctuations and market volatility. Some investors don't even look at their profits or losses until they receive their monthly or quarterly statements. If all goes according to plan, they find that the value of their investment has increased over time. One of the most successful buy and hold investors in history, Warren Buffett, likes to say that he is not buying a stock, he is buying a business. He buys stocks for the best price he can and holds them as long as possible. Buffett buys stock in conservative, some would say dull corporations, like insurance companies and banks, and rarely buys technology stocks. He became a billionaire using his long-term buy and hold investment strategy. A strategy is a plan that helps an investor achieve a certain goal. When investing, the goal is earning money. investors who bought and held shares of stock in Amazon, Apple, Walmart, Netflix, Microsoft, Salesforce, Nike's, and hundreds of other companies saw the value of their investments soar over time. During the best years, the stock market rallied by huge amounts, and the price of the best-performing stocks doubled or tripled. That's as sweet as it gets for investors. During these times, when the market keeps rising for years, it is called a bull market. Unfortunately, there are times when it's unprofitable to be an investor, during a bear market, when the market generally goes down. During the worst bear markets, it's possible for a year's worth of gains to be erased within weeks. Fortunately for investors, over the long term, the market has tended to move higher more often than it has declined. I will discuss bull and bear markets in more detail in Chapter 4. Short-term traders make money quickly. Unlike investors, short-term traders don't care about the long-term prospects of their stocks. They are focused on the short-term movements of the stock price. Their goal is to take advantage of volatility, extreme price movements, to make money. This means that they may buy and then sell a stock within minutes, a few hours, or days, or even a few weeks. Professional high-frequency traders who use computers to make the trade may hold positions for only microseconds. There are many kinds of short-term traders. Trading strategies include day trading, holding no longer than a day, swing trading, holding for 3 to 5 days until a price target is reached, and position trading, holding for weeks or a few months. Day traders buy and sell stocks quickly, taking profits before the market closes for the day. We will discuss all these strategies in detail in later chapters. Trading stocks is a lot more exciting than investing because the payoff is faster, and when you're right, it's possible to make substantial profits. When investing, wealth is built more slowly over a long time period. When trading, the goal is to make profits every day, week, or few months. As you will discover, it's more challenging to make money as a short-term trader, but the rewards are often immediate. Professional trader, using OPM to make money. Professional traders typically want to use other people's money, OPM, and less often their own, to invest or trade. They charge a fee for their services. Professionals include institutional traders, such as pension funds, banks, insurance companies, mutual fund companies, and hedge funds. These institutional investors have access to billions of dollars, and when they buy and sell huge numbers of shares, they can influence not only the price of individual stocks, but the entire market. Some institutions set up high-speed computer programs, that is, algorithms, that automatically buy and sell stocks when certain parameters, that is, price levels, are met. Many high-frequency traders make thousands of trades per second in order to capture a few pennies in profits. Those pennies can add up to large profits each day. Some describe this strategy as picking up pennies in front of a steamroller, a strategy not recommended for amateurs. Not all institutional traders are high-frequency traders. In fact, most professionals avoid high-frequency trading and use a variety of long-term and short-term strategies to make money for their clients and themselves. It is estimated that professional traders, including computer algorithms, make up approximately 90% of the daily volume in the market. Retail investors make up the other 10%. Two important questions. Before going on to the next chapter, here are two questions that beginning investors often ask. 1. Question: how much money do I need to get started? Answer: you can open an account at most brokerage firms for $0, no cash required. Eventually, you must add money to the account before you will be allowed to trade. You can check online or call the brokerage firm to find out the exact requirements. 2. Question: how much money can I lose? Answer: in a worst-case scenario, you can lose all the money you invested. And if you go on margin, borrowing funds from the broker, which is not recommended, you can lose more money than you invested. Even with these risks, I encourage you to learn about and participate in the stock market. By listening to this book, you will learn how to avoid losing your money. Here's an email I received from a reader who was concerned that he didn't have enough money to live on. He hoped that the stock market would solve his financial problems. He wrote, "I am 71 years old and am just starting to study stocks because I don't have a retirement fund to lean on. I am working 3 jobs and know I can't keep doing this for much longer. What should I do?" He wanted to know what strategies he should use to make money fast. I feel bad for this man because he is financially vulnerable. No one wants to wake up one day and realize there is no money for emergencies or even for survival. Therefore, one of the biggest mistakes you can make is not investing at all. I hope this man finds a way to reduce expenses and debt while increasing income. I'm not a financial planner or analyst, so I was unable to give him specific advice, but I suggested he get competent financial guidance, and quickly. It's not too late. The good news for this man, and the millions of others who have been left out of the stock market, is that it's not too late. Conservative strategies can be used to reduce some of the financial burdens of investing, and my hope is to increase income. I wrote this book for him, and millions of others who don't know what to do and feel lost because they have been left behind. The biggest problem for this man is that time is running out. Because he wants to start investing so late in life, it will take some time to get started. If you are listening to this and you are young or middle-aged, you are fortunate that you have time to invest for the short and long term. However, if you, like this man, are past retirement age, you can still make money in the stock market or elsewhere. At first, the most important goal is to get out of debt and cut expenses. Do not bet money on the stock market when you need that money to pay bills. In addition, although short-term trading strategies are included in this book, I don't want anyone to believe it's easy to make money quickly. It takes hard work and study to be a successful short-term trader. And that's one of the reasons why I believe you should first get your feet wet by investing before you try your hand at short-term trading. Note: as you listen through this book, you will be introduced to a lot of different vocabulary words. If you ever need a more detailed explanation of any words or concepts, you can go to Investopedia's website, investopedia.com, to find a definition. History of the stock market. In 1531, government bonds and notes were traded in Antwerp, Belgium, but not stocks, because stocks didn't exist yet. Likewise, the Hamburg Stock Exchange in Germany was created in 1558, but once again, only goods were traded, not stocks or bonds. Most historians agree that the world's first organized stock exchange began in Amsterdam in 1602 by the Dutch East India Company, where stocks, bonds, and other securities were traded. In the United States, the first U.S. securities exchange was founded in 1790 in Philadelphia, and although the participants traded many financial products, they didn't trade stocks. 2 years later, in 1792, the first organized meeting place for buyers and sellers of stock occurred under a buttonwood tree in New York City. It just happened that the name of the street where all this took place was Wall Street. For history buffs, the buttonwood tree was at 68 Wall Street. When people heard about what was happening on Wall Street, they wanted a piece of the action. Some days, as many as 100 shares of stock were exchanged. In today's market, billions of shares of stock change hands every day. It got so crowded under the buttonwood tree that 24 prominent brokers and merchants decided to organize what they were doing. For a fixed commission, they agreed to buy and sell shares of stock in corporations to the public. They gave themselves 25 cents for each share of stock they traded. Today we would call these people stockbrokers. The Buttonwood Agreement was signed in 1792. This was the humble beginning of the New York Stock Exchange. It wasn't long before the brokers and merchants moved their offices to a Wall Street coffee shop. Eventually, they moved indoors to the New York Stock Exchange building on Wall Street. Even after 200 years, the name Wall Street is used to describe the entire U.S. stock market, including the financial institutions that the brokers do business with, no matter where those institutions and brokers are located. If you go to New York, you'll see that Wall Street is just a narrow street in the financial district of Lower Manhattan. The market or Wall Street, is really a convenient way of talking about anyone or anything connected with our financial markets. Now that you have an idea of how to get started as an investor or trader, the first step is to open a brokerage account. All the financial products you will buy and sell will be found at the brokerage firm. Chapter 2. Opening a brokerage account. Now that you have an overview of the stock market, it's time to take the next step to get started investing. In this chapter, I show you how to open a brokerage account. Opening an account is similar to opening a bank account, but with more investment choices. Let's go through the steps to open an account. Fortunately, it's easy to do, and most people complete the application online. If you prefer to open an account in person, you can go to the office of the brokerage firm, if it has a brick-and-mortar building. Step 1. Choose a brokerage firm with a good reputation. To buy stocks or other investment products, you must have an account with a brokerage firm. This is an important decision. If you choose the wrong firm, it can cost money in unnecessary fees or poor order fills, that is, execution of your order. Because all brokerage firms have a website, most firms will allow you to buy or sell orders from your computer or online device. It's easy to do, and most online orders are processed within seconds. On rare occasions, during an extremely volatile market, orders can be delayed. The most popular brokerage firms have nationally known reputations, a 12-hour help desk to answer questions by phone or chat, easy-to-navigate screens, streaming real-time stock quotes, rapid trade execution, and they will allow you to trade a variety of financial products. Most brokerage firms have educational resources and information about investing and trading strategies, such as articles, webinars, and podcasts. The top firms offer research with sophisticated charts, trade alerts, customizable screens, and profit and loss figures. Although it's not required, I also recommend finding a broker with a simulated or paper money trading program that allows you to practice making trades. In addition, many brokers have scanning programs in their trading software that allow you to search and scan for stocks and other products that meet certain criteria. Before signing with a broker, call, email, or chat with the representatives to see how quickly they respond to questions. If you are satisfied with the service, it's easy to apply for an online account. It's also simple to cancel an account if you are dissatisfied for any reason. Nevertheless, try to find a brokerage firm with representatives who patiently answer questions and solve problems as they occur. Note: many brokerage firms have offices where you can meet with financial representatives. They have a variety of titles, but in reality, they are stockbrokers. These firms are eager to manage your money, especially if you have a lot of assets. Scam alert. Be certain to sign up with a well-known, reputable brokerage. Be careful of scammers who create glossy, professional brokerage websites that look real. Their job is to try and convince you to transfer money to their fake firm. Never work with a firm that requires cryptocurrencies instead of currency, because digital currencies are unregulated. Ignore strangers on the internet who brag about how they routinely make $25,000 to $50,000 a day and will share their knowledge only if you sign up with their firm. If you're listening to this book from outside the United States, you must be even more careful. Many fraudsters operate with impunity from their home countries because of lax regulations. That means any money transferred to them, especially with cryptocurrencies, will never be recovered. There are three main types of brokerage firms: online, full service, and discount, which I will explain later. Online brokerage firms. Online brokerage firms are the easiest and most popular to use when trading stocks. Online investing or trading simply means entering buy and sell orders over the internet from your own computer or mobile device. All brokerage firms have a website that allows customers to buy and sell stocks in addition to other financial products, such as bonds, index funds, mutual funds, and fixed income products, such as CDs and treasuries. In the old days of trading, the first 200 years, clients were charged a commission for every trade, which often added up to big bucks. Once brokerage firms went online, competition increased, commissions plunged, and eventually commissions were completely removed. Zero commissions fueled a rise in short-term strategies, including day trading and buying options. The downside to opening an account with an online brokerage is that these firms offer little or no investment advice. That's probably why you're listening to this book. If you feel that investment advice is needed, or if you have a huge portfolio that is difficult to manage, an online broker may not be right for you. You may prefer a full-service broker, a decision only you can make. Where can you find a current list of the top-rated online brokerage firms? Go to any search engine and type Rank Online Brokerage Firms, followed by the current year. This will bring up a list of articles from independent sources such as Forbes, Barron's, MarketWatch, Kiplinger, NerdWallet, and Bankrate that will help guide your decision. Full-service brokerage firms. Bells and whistles, for a price. Full-service brokerage firms include some of the largest and most influential stock brokerage firms on Wall Street. These brokerage firms provide a variety of banking and investment products, primarily geared to wealthy clientele who don't have the time or desire to manage their own accounts. Unless you have a large portfolio, don't expect to receive a high level of personalized service. If you open an account with a full-service brokerage firm, you will be assigned a stockbroker to handle your account. Stockbrokers, who refer to themselves as financial consultants, account executives, investment managers, money managers, or account representatives, are paid to offer advice about buying and selling, and to get your orders to the electronic trading floor for execution. Be aware that these brokers require more time to enter an order than online brokers. Typically, representatives are paid a percentage of the cash in your account. Don't be afraid to ask the percentage they are paid, because the fee structure is different at each firm. Clients with larger accounts usually get better rates and service. If you hire a stockbroker at a full-service brokerage firm, my advice is to find an honest, competent individual who truly cares about your investment portfolio. Often, stockbrokers at these firms know little about stocks and are instead salespeople. If the broker is a fiduciary, the law requires the broker to work in your best interest and not in the broker's own interest. If you open an account with a full-service broker, monitor the account closely and make sure you have final approval for any investment decisions the broker makes. By listening to this book, you will gain more confidence and knowledge, which should help you make financial decisions. Another choice for those of you with significant sums to manage is to hire a money manager to handle your entire portfolio for a yearly or quarterly fee. Money managers typically have a relationship to one or more brokerage firms and make their trades through them. Because you will be paying a fee to that broker, find out what those charges will be. Although this may sound confusing, don't be afraid to ask questions, no matter which method you choose. Most importantly, you must know how to buy and sell stocks independently, whether you do it alone or hire someone to do it. Discount brokers. No frill trading for zero cost. Discount brokers grew in popularity in the early days of the internet, but now many have merged with larger firms. As a result, these brokerages no longer refer to themselves as discount brokers. Nowadays, the terms online brokers and discount brokers are nearly synonymous. Discount brokers are always online and allow you to make your own trades, but they do not provide investment advice or guide you in any way. Step 2. Open a brokerage account. Once you select a broker, you can communicate with the firm via phone, online, or in person if it has local offices. If you ask, the firm will send you an enrollment packet via email. When you enroll, the broker will ask questions about your investment experience, your financial goals, the products you want to trade, and the amount of risk you are willing to accept, from low risk to high risk. Don't worry too much about the questionnaire. It's used for informational purposes. Once you finish this book, answering the questionnaire will be a breeze. Eventually, you must fund the account with at least a few $100. Ask the firm about its minimum requirement. As a rule, you always want extra cash in your account so that you can buy or sell financial products. Fund the account with a check or transfer money from your bank. That money is usually deposited into a cash account, probably a money market account. What is margin? One question the broker will ask is whether you want to use a margin account. Margin allows you to borrow money from the brokerage to buy more shares than you can afford to pay with your deposited cash, If you are a beginner, I recommend not applying for margin. Margin has caused problems for investors who don't understand how much money can be lost when things don't go their way. You can always add it later. Typically, margin is 1-to-1. For example, if you have $2,500 in your account, the brokerage will let you borrow up to an additional $2,500. This gives you $5,000 in buying power. However, it's not free money. You must pay interest on the borrowed cash. The advantage of margin is that you are using the broker's money to make more money. This is called leverage. Leveraging works great if your investment increases in value. On the other hand, if the stock you choose declines in value, not only do you lose all or some of your original investment, which is painful enough, but you'll still owe the broker the money that was borrowed. This adds extra risk to any investment using margin. If the prices of the stocks that you own plunge after you borrowed cash to buy them, you might get the dreaded margin call. The broker will demand that you provide more cash or equities to fund the account, or sell some of the shares. There is no bargaining. You must meet the margin call. If you don't react quickly enough, the broker will sell some of your positions until the margin percentage is at the proper level, usually 30% or higher. In my opinion, margin is a risky method, best left to experienced traders. Invest what you can afford, without borrowing. If you don't heed this advice, you will quickly know what I mean after you receive that first margin call. What equipment do you need? All you need to get started as an investor or trader is a computer, smartphone, or tablet. Before the internet, it was hard for retail investors to trade stocks. We had to rely on a stockbroker to make the trades, and the commission cost was often high, as much as $100 per trade, depending on the size of the order. With improved technology and $0 commissions, it has never been easier to participate in the stock market. I have found that an iPad or other tablet is an ideal device to study the market and read the news. Many people still place trades with a computer, but more and more people are doing their trading on mobile devices. History of the Stock Exchange. After the New York Stock Exchange, NYSE, was established in 1792, brokers who could not meet the financial requirements for trading on the New York Stock Exchange moved their operations to the street curb. They were given the name curbside brokers. In 1911, these brokers became known as the New York Curb Market. In 1921, the curbside brokers finally moved indoors to a building on Greenwich Street and changed their name to the New York Curb Exchange. In 1952, the exchange was renamed to the American Stock Exchange, AMEX. In addition to the NYSE and AMEX, the third stock exchange was the National Association of Securities Dealers Automated Quotation System, NASDAQ, which was created in 1971. This was the first electronic stock exchange, and members were linked together by a network of computers. In order to compete more effectively, many of the smaller stock exchanges, including the American Stock Exchange, merged with the NYSE in 2008. The NASDAQ also gobbled up some of the smaller exchanges, but kept its name. If you are in the United States, more than likely you will buy stocks on one of the two major U.S. stock exchanges, the NYSE or NASDAQ. Although this history is interesting, it won't affect you as an investor. It doesn't matter at what exchange you buy stocks. Stock exchanges exist in nearly every country in the world, although the U.S. market is the largest. Other countries with stock exchanges include Germany, the United Kingdom, Switzerland, France, the Netherlands, Russia, Japan, China, Sweden, Italy, Brazil, Mexico, Canada, Australia, Denmark, Hong Kong, India, South Korea, Finland, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Iceland, Armenia, Taiwan, South Africa, Spain, Singapore, Thailand, Indonesia, Ukraine, Turkey, Hungary, Saudi Arabia, and nearly all the countries in Asia, Africa, the European Union, and Latin America, not mentioned before. Joining a stock exchange. It's not easy for a corporation to be listed on a stock exchange, because each exchange has specific listing standards. It may take years for a new corporation to meet all the rules and regulations and have its stock listed for trading on the exchange. For example, the companies that are listed on the NYSE are some of the best-known and largest corporations in the world. Blue-chip corporations such as 3M, American Express, AT&T, Boeing, Caterpillar, Chevron, Cigna, Coca-Cola, DuPont, Home Depot, Honeywell, IBM, Johnson & Johnson, Lowe's, McDonald's, Merck, Nike, Procter & Gamble, Salesforce, Travelers, United Health, Visa, Walmart, and Walt Disney. More than 2,800 stocks trade on the NYSE. The NASDAQ, on the other hand, is both a stock exchange and an index. The NASDAQ index contains many technology corporations, including Alphabet, Amazon, Apple, Cisco Systems, Intel, Meta, Microsoft, Netflix, and NVIDIA. More than 3,300 stocks trade on the NASDAQ exchange. In addition to the NASDAQ and NYSE, more than 12,000 stocks are traded over-the-counter, OTC, rather than on an exchange. Some of these companies are large, but most are small. Some meet the SEC, Securities and Exchange Commission, requirements for being listed on an exchange, while others don't. It is recommended that you research these companies thoroughly. That is, do your due diligence before investing in OTC stocks. Finally, there are also stocks that don't meet the requirements of the SEC and are listed on the pink sheets. My suggestion? Don't buy any stocks listed on the pink sheets. They may be easy to buy, but are hard to sell at a good price. Now that you have opened and funded a brokerage account, it's time to take the next step, and that is to start investing or trading. I will begin by teaching you how to create a watch list, which is simply a list of the most important stocks you plan to follow. Creating a watch list is the first step in learning how to trade or invest. Chapter 3. Your watch list. By now, you probably opened a brokerage account, or you're thinking about it, and are eager to buy that first stock. I urge you to wait a little longer before investing real money into the market. It is wise to research and study before buying. In this chapter, I will teach you how to create a watch list, which is a list of the stocks or other financial products that you are thinking of buying or already own. Maintaining a list of stocks to follow is essential because it forces you to know about the companies whose shares you plan to own. The watch list is in your brokerage account software. Consider it like home base. Unfortunately, many people skip this step because they don't realize how important it is. The alternative is to buy stocks based on tips or hunches. I don't want you to fall into that trap. Let's begin by learning how to find stocks using your own watch list. What stocks to put on your watch list? Before you actually buy and sell stocks, you may be thinking, where do I find stocks that will make me money? The short answer is, everywhere. Unfortunately, while it's easy to get ideas of what stocks to buy, it's not always easy to make money from them. By the end of this book, however, you will learn how to do both. First, we need to get stock ideas. That's the easy part. The challenge is to separate the wheat from the chaff, that is, to invest in stocks that are true money makers. Winning stocks bring profits, sometimes for a day or week, but the best stock provides gains for months, years, or even decades.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.